Hey guys, welcome back to my channel. This is Sandra and I make videos all about personal finance, work vlogs, as well as just work in general. So this video is kind of going to be a spin-off of the first video that I did about how to get into cybersecurity without any prior experience, and I can link that video in the description below if you guys are interested. But I feel like that video did really well and a lot of you guys are really interested in just getting started in cybersecurity, so I figured I would share a few more resources on top of the ones that I already covered in that video and kind of go a little more in depth so you guys know exactly what to look for, what resources to use if you're interviewing, and just different ways that you can get more information about the field. The more information that you have, the better, especially going to interviews when they ask you questions about current events and stuff like that. So the first two I already talked about in the first video, which is Capture the Flag and Hack the Box. And I don't want to cover this too in depth because I already talked about it in the last video, but I still feel like it's really important just in terms of getting the skill set to actually do pen testing, ethical hacking, anything that has to do with red teaming or the more offensive side of cybersecurity. And I really feel like it's more helpful that way just to do something hands-on. So Capture the Flag is basically some kind of event. A lot of companies host this, the government hosts this, schools host it. They're basically just limited time events where there is some kind of vulnerable website or endpoint, or maybe it's a physical machine that they have. They allow participants to hack into this website and use whatever tools at their disposal to basically just get into the site and find flags. And these flags are usually just some kind of code or something that you enter into a specific area, and then that's how you get the points for Capture the Flag. So for some of them you might have to use Burp Suite, Ramina, Bloodhound, Metasploit, basically just a bunch of different tools. You can probably look up the list of most popular tools that are used for Capture the Flags, because these are also most likely the tools used for actual offensive roles or like jobs if you're starting an interview or looking for different positions. So I really feel like getting familiar with these tools and at least knowing what they're used for is really helpful. And of course I'm not a pro at it. I still feel like I'm very beginner, but I actually got started with pen testing as part of a Capture the Flag event. So that's kind of where I dip my foot in the water and kind of got a taste of what it's like. And obviously I didn't finish the event because I was just so beginner, but I feel like I think I got like 30% of the way in, and that was like on top of my normal work stuff. So I felt pretty good about that first one that I did, and I've probably done about two or three since then. But I really feel like practice makes perfect, and I'm by no means perfect at this or great at this in my opinion. So yeah, I really think getting started is the first thing to do. And once you first start it, there's no guide in particular when you're looking for things. So sometimes I can hit a dead end, and if you do, just know that sometimes taking a break, taking a step back and then coming back like a day later after a good night's sleep is really gonna help, because sometimes you just need clarity rather than staring at it for hours on end. And a Hack the Box is something similar, but it's not like a limited time where you have to solve a specific challenge. It's kind of like LeetCode, where there's different challenges. There's an invite link in my description. It's free to use, and it's not like my specific invite link. It's just, it's kind of like the first challenge that you have to do to get into or to make a Hack the Box account. So yeah, that one's pretty fun. You guys should definitely try it. There's guides online that you can follow if you're completely new to this. That's fine. I mean, I did that walkthrough with one of my mentors when I first started all this Capture the Flag stuff too, so yeah. Okay, so another resource that I think is really, really useful, just from talking to mentors that have been on red teams or offensive security teams, they use a lot of different sources for information. And of course there's like threat intel teams that kind of gather all this stuff and put it into one big monthly report or something that you can view, or you know, the open source type intelligence that you can use. But I feel like knowing this information yourself too, or just having a background of it in case your manager asks you about this event or some kind of security breach, you kind of have an idea of it. I think that's really useful just in terms of also getting an internship or getting a job for this too, and at least knowing the really big breaches that have happened in like the last 5, 10, 20 years. And these could come from security blogs or Feedly. And security blogs like Krebs on Security and different things like that, where they basically just post articles about different things that have happened and how attacks happened, kind of like the technical concepts of an attack. And of course, news articles about actual hacks, like the recent one from an ATP in Russia, which is a nation state threat. It's just really good to know these things and just stay on top of the news that's happening in your sector. And I really think it's important. And then Feedly is basically an RSS feed that combines all of them together, and I usually skim through some of them, and then usually the most prominent ones will stick out to me and I'll read those. I don't read every single one, but I think it's a really good way to just keep track of different things and also just know what's going on. And you never know when someone's gonna ask you a question about it, whether it be your boss or even like your mom or your grandma who might be worried about someone hacking into their account or something. So yeah, it's just really good information to know. And it shows that you're constantly learning, constantly looking out for the newest technologies, newest hacks, the newest breaches. And that's definitely something that employers want to see, because they want you to be engaged and proactive and knowing where to find your information and knowing what's important and what's not, and keeping up with current events. Okay, and another thing that's similar to these is just Twitter. So I've talked to so many people who are like, yeah, I just found this on Twitter, or I follow these security people on Twitter, and they basically just follow everyone on Twitter. And Twitter is where people just post articles like, hey, I just uploaded this new article, or I wrote this post for some news outlet, or this is a new type of attack that we're seeing. And what's really nice about this is that you're not just following people who are writing articles or blogs, you're also following people who are CISOs, security executives, people who wrote books about security, people who are in academia and doing cybersecurity research, companies that are focused on cybersecurity solutions. I feel like Twitter is kind of like a goldmine of information, and I've had people that I know who have found mentors on Twitter by following certain Twitter accounts that are, you know, in the cybersecurity realm. And then after a while, they reach out to them and say, hey, I really like all the content that you're posting, and would you mind like mentoring me or something, or chatting with me about your background and how you got to where you are and your current role and, you know, the things that you do to keep up with the field. I really feel like it's a really good networking tool, because you kind of get to interact with that person directly. So I definitely recommend using Twitter as a tool to you. You can probably also do something similar on LinkedIn, but Twitter is the one that I've heard just good things about, because everyone's on Twitter and you don't have to connect with them, you can just follow them. But I think you can also follow on LinkedIn, but yeah, you know what I mean. Okay, so another really good resource is conferences and B-sides. So I'm sure we've all heard of RSA Conference, Black Hat. There's a lot of really prominent conferences that are out there for cybersecurity, and I really recommend checking all of them out. I know a lot of these cost money, so you should definitely check out B-sides, which are kind of similar, but I believe they all are free. I can double check that, but basically they're conferences that are more local in your area, and they're usually held at universities or schools or some kind of community center, and they're basically conferences set up by the local cybersecurity community. And I've known people who have set up their own talks here, and it's just really nice and engaging just to meet different professionals in your area, meet different people who might be in a role that you want to be in, and you can connect with them one-on-one and learn from their presentations. Conferences are basically just a bunch of different talks and presentations about certain breaches, certain attacks, certain security topics, and all of them have different topics, but a lot of them also have capture the flags or different workshop type tutorials where you're basically hacking with the person and they're kind of guiding you. Kind of like a course, I guess, at a school. So conferences are definitely a lot bigger and more well-funded than B-sides, but B-sides are also free, or very little money to get into, and you can go as a, you know, local person, and they have them all in like major cities. So I think if you look up the B-sides website, but basically they have all the information, most major cities have it, and I believe a lot of them were virtual in 2020 just because of the pandemic. I definitely recommend checking them out, because since they were virtual, a lot of them were uploaded onto YouTube, and you can probably look up a whole bunch of different conference topics from B-sides on there if you want to check them out for free. So yeah, it's just a really good resource, and you can learn something new that you probably wouldn't be learning in your textbooks or classes that you are attending or have attended. And then of course another thing is certifications. I recently got my CompTIA Security Plus certification back in November, and if you guys didn't already know, my background is not in cybersecurity at all. My background is in software development and a little bit of data analytics, big data. So because I didn't have any, you know, official cybersecurity certifications or experiences after I graduated college, I found the Security Plus really, really helpful, because I mean, honestly, if you asked me to configure a firewall, if you asked me about setting up roles and rules and restrictions, I would have no idea what you're talking about, because I don't understand those concepts and those terms don't mean anything to me, because I've just never studied those or used them in any professional or academic setting. So because I took the Security Plus exam, I was just introduced to a lot of different concepts that I have honestly never really heard about. I didn't even know there were more than two different types of Bluetooth and the differences between them, but all this is covered in Security Plus. I really recommend it as a beginner-friendly type certification if you're trying to break into cybersecurity. If you're more advanced, of course there's CISSP, the CEH, there's a lot of different ones out there depending on what you're looking for and what kind of roles you're trying to expand into, but I think the Security Plus, Network Plus, A Plus, those are all decent ones to start with. CompTIA also has combined certifications now, so if you take, I think it was like the Security Plus and the Network Plus combined, you get another certification because we took those two together, or something like that. I don't really know. But I know I had a mentor who did something similar, and he basically got another certification because he had both of those. So I really think looking into it would be a really good option if you're looking for a new role in cybersecurity. But that definitely helped me become a lot more confident just in terms of what I'm talking about when I'm in a meeting and I hear a concept and I kind of have an idea of what it actually means and what they're actually doing. Because otherwise, when someone's talking about wireless access point and you might know what it is, but you don't know exactly the technical specifications of it or what it means to have the evil twin or a rogue AP, like that's all stuff that you need to know when you sit into these, when you sit in these meetings and people are just talking really fast and you want to understand what's going on outside of just taking notes. So yeah, I really recommend Security Plus because it's helped me a lot. And even if it doesn't come up in work on like a day-to-day basis, it's just been really helpful knowing that. And I really feel like getting a certification is one of the first steps in getting your foot in the door, especially if you're first starting out. And the last thing is LinkedIn mentors. So this is really similar to Twitter, but I really think that reaching out to people is one of the best ways to expand your network and get a job. And that's really what people are trying to do if you're trying to get into cybersecurity, right? So I really feel like your connections, your warm connections, are gonna help you a lot more than just applying for a job on a career website, because that's just how it is. And in the digital world, you need to have digital connections. So let's say there's a really good LinkedIn article that you read, you connected with a person who is part of a cybersecurity role at a company that you're kind of interested in, and you're following him for maybe a few weeks, a few months, and you see other articles, and then you're connected, and then after a few weeks, a few months, you reach out and ask, hey, I've been following your articles for a while now, I really like your content about XYZ, I would love to learn more about your background, how you got to where you are, and just get to know more about your role in general. A lot of people like to talk about themselves. People like to talk about their background, people like to talk about all your successes, all your roles, and you know, it's just like another way of networking and also hearing more about their sides. It's kind of like a win-win situation, and you can do that to a few people and just kind of see whoever says yes or no. And never be afraid of rejection, because at the end of the day, a rejection just means that they weren't helping you before and they still aren't helping you now, so nothing has changed. You know, like that should make you feel better. That should take the pressure off of yourself to feel like you need to hear a yes, or take off that feeling of being let down or feeling like, why won't this person want to talk to me or something from rejection, because either way, they weren't gonna help you and they weren't helping you before either. So nothing in your life has changed from this person not responding to you or leaving you on read or rejecting your offer to talk to them. And I really feel like that's something that everyone needs to learn at some point, and I've gotten pretty used to it. And honestly, I'm okay with that because I feel like people are busy. I give people the benefit of the doubt. If they don't want to talk to me, then that's okay. You know, I don't feel like they have to talk to me just because I asked them. So yeah, if someone doesn't want to talk to you, it's fine. There's going to be someone else who is willing to help you, willing to mentor you, willing to add you to their network and help you find that new role, or help provide you resources to get to your new role. And eventually, if you find someone that really clicks with you, you can eventually ask them to be your mentor. And that's going to be really beneficial to you, just to have someone who's already in the field, have someone to learn from, have someone to bring up questions to whenever you're having a career change or having questions about cybersecurity or anything security related. And it's just really helpful to have someone on your bench to kind of go to for advice. So that's it for this video. I hope you guys liked it. I feel like I talked a lot and really fast, and I'm sorry for that. I always try to not talk really fast, but I always do that. I don't know why. But yeah, thank you guys so much for watching. I hope you guys liked the video. Please give this video a thumbs up if you liked it, and subscribe and turn on post notifications. I post videos every Wednesday at 2 p.m. and Sundays at 12 p.m. And I will see you guys in my next video. Bye.